recent years, we have witnessed the greatest transformation to work in a century. The rapid rise of AI and machine learning, as well as the shift towards hybrid work and redefined employee expectations, has reshaped the world of work and, in turn, the role of human resource leaders. Organisations are increasingly looking to these HR leaders to inform strategy, recognising that the alignment of people to processes and technology is crucial to success. And that is why we were commissioned by Workday to conduct research into the Forever Forward HR leader. And so joining me today to discuss some of these insights from this study is McCrindle's Director of Strategy, Grant Dusting. Grant, welcome back to the podcast.
Oh, thank you for having me, Ash.
It's a delight to talk about this important topic. We actually work a lot, I think, with HR leaders, and we present to them a lot around trends defining the future of work and we're We are specialists in human behavior, and these are also specialists in human behavior in HR and human resources. So there's definitely a natural sort of alignment there, I think. So this report, this research was really interesting. I wonder, Grant, if you wanted to maybe kick us off by starting with some of the key findings, key takeaways that this research sort of uncovered.
Yeah, well, I really loved this research we conducted for a few reasons. Like one, the working with the team at Workday, and Catherine was amazing to work with and love working with their team. But also because this research we conducted was across Asia Pacific. And I think includes, like, we were really, the challenge that was brought to us, to McCrindle when Workday reached out was in terms of, like, we know business leaders and HR leaders have experienced a whole lot of change over the last few years, and particularly since the pandemic, with not only have we had the pandemic to deal with, and HR leaders have been navigating, like, supporting people and processes, you know, as they've had to be broken down and then reformed since then. Mm. And then that includes obviously the flexible and hybrid working models, which you've talked about on this podcast before. I mean, we've had the great resignation post-COVID, and we've got Gen Z really hitting the workforce in greater numbers now as, like, the next, you know, the new generation in the workforce. And then, of course, throwing AI into the mix in the last couple of years, or generative AI at least, and the impacts there. So yeah, a lot of things for people leaders and business leaders to be grappling with. And I think the thing is, there's not a lot of the data that is produced is, like, very US centric. And so this was a great opportunity for us to conduct something that was more Asia Pacific focused. So in the end, we ran a survey of over 1500 senior managers and HR professionals across Asia Pacific and Japan, people who work in large companies. So we're talking here, like, companies with 300 plus staff. So really trying to look at those kind of enterprise size companies. Often these are, yeah, very large multinational companies, and speaking to those leaders and saying, well, what are you noticing? What are you observing? And really the insights we've got and the things we've pulled from, yeah, it's exciting because it reflects such a senior audience and not just in Australia, but right across Asia Pacific.
Mm. Yeah, it's really interesting area to be exploring. And like you said, there are so many trends, technological, demographic, economic, that have kind of shaped all the things that HR leaders have had to deal with, and that all of us have had to deal with, but HR in a really specific sort of context in terms of leading the people in their organizations. So yeah, it's been a tumultuous couple of years, I imagine, for many of these people we've surveyed.
Yeah, and we, you know, we often reference the statement from Justin Trudeau, the pace of change has never been this fast, yet it would never be this slow again. And a lot of people feel like, oh yeah, that's exactly how I feel. But he made those comments in 2018. So it's crazy to think that since, you know, in the last 5 years, we've seen all these other things even since then. So yeah. I think just the challenge for business leaders and people leaders to try to, navigate all the challenges. I think we've got some really great insights here about what leaders are doing to kind of keep ahead of the trends.
Mm. And you mentioned those challenges, Grant, and I'd be keen to hear what you think, based on this research and these insights, what are the main issues people in this profession are experiencing or facing, because my hypothesis is that, and my experience, a lot of the time when we look at an area or an industry that we might not be familiar with, we might think, oh, it's the topic that gets the most kind of attention or that we hear about the most. Like, I imagine a lot of people think, oh, AI has got to be the big one around the future of work, or flexibility. But oftentimes there are other, and sometimes we say, I think it's not the waves, but the tides. Like, it's the biggest set sort of longer term trends that are shaping the future of industry, that in professionals within it are going, yeah, AI is important, but what's more important is XYZ. So wondering if you could, yeah, tell us what professionals in this area, in this industry, were saying are the biggest things they're sort of facing and thinking about as they think about the future of HR.
Yeah. Or even just picking up on your comment, Ash, about, and I love that framing of, was it looking at the tides, not the waves? And I think that's such a challenge when you're in the, like, really in the thick of organizational change, and you've got, you know, staffing, you're trying to focus on retention. And so, yeah, I think this study, like, one of the, I will answer your question about the top challenges, but I think even just before that, like, one of the kind of key themes that we saw, which aligns with things we've already been noticing and talking about through our presentations, is when it comes to the future of work, yeah, people often default to thinking about technology and AI, but actually, the data we got here just reinforces what we've already been saying, that the future of work is actually more human, not less human. Mm. And the focus on the human, like putting the human back in human resources, if we say it that way, like that's I think even more important than ever. The role of people leaders is really paramount. So some key, like, in asking leaders about, like, what are the key challenges that they're facing and they're prioritizing, there was really, I mean, there's a lot of challenges, and we've listed a few already, but there was two clear kind of key themes that emerged. One is the challenge of attracting and retaining the best and brightest talent. And I mean, that's probably not news to anyone, but that is definitely a heightened challenge at the moment. We've got such a competitive market for jobs, the people have a lot of opportunities available to them, and they're not limited by geography as much anymore, because it's kind of a global playing field, particularly for a lot of the larger companies and the ones that we were talking to in this study. So that's, you know, talent acquisition was the top challenge that business leaders outlined, and staff retention came in third as well. So really, yeah, attracting and retaining top talent. I mean, where, you know, you're giving a lot of presentations on that topic through the year, particularly around the next generation of workers, Gen Z, right? So this study just highlighted that remains front and center, like the key challenge for business and HR leaders. And the other kind of key theme was around, and they are definitely related, but the other key theme besides attracting and retaining is a challenge of upskilling, training and developing. Because, and I think that, again, that if you train and develop and upskill people well, that's going to help retention. We know that. So it's linked in that sense. But also it's a product of just how quickly the world's changing. And I think employers feeling that challenge of, well, for us as a business to stay competitive, to be productive, we need to keep learning and developing ourselves and doing that for our team. So those two things, attracting and retaining the best and brightest talent, and then really upskilling, training and developing staff, like those things, they really featured in kind of the top five challenges, was really all around those things there.
Yeah, it's definitely a really big challenge, and like you said, Grant, it's one that we get asked to talk about all the time in conferences and at events. And yeah, it's really interesting the connection there between attracting and retaining, and then also training and upskilling. And we have talked about this before on this podcast about our prediction that a school leaver today will have 18 jobs across 6 careers, and that being based on the average tenure of someone staying in one job for around 3 years or just under. So that's how we kind of extrapolate that out and get that statistic or prediction. And I know when I talk about that in presentations, you probably find the same. And then you talk about the need for training and people go, oh, well, that's a, not a tall order or a huge ask, but training is costly and expensive time-wise and raw costs. And so is staff turnover. And it's hard, I guess, for people to think about investing in their people when they're just going to kind of leave and turn over so quickly. And I remember once I was sharing about this at a conference and someone said, oh, you might be worried about what if they train them and they leave. And then they also said, but we might need to think about what if we don't train them and they stay. And I thought, well, that's clever, isn't it, in terms of flipping it around. So it's just this kind of reality of, yes, people are changing jobs more frequently, but the reality of training people and upskilling is so important to the people you have in your team for the organization's benefit, but also for their own development. If people aren't developing or growing, then I feel like that's a key part of why people do choose to leave, especially if they're younger. So,
yeah, definitely. And I think that highlights how there's those two aspects to training and development. It's one is the keeping staff engaged and retaining them and a fulfilling and kind of enjoyable work environment where there's that constant learning. But then also there's the business reality side of actually the world keeps changing. And so, like, yeah, we've got to keep on our toes as a team. And that definitely came through very strongly. And there was this theme of leaders taking a skills-based strategy and really thinking in those terms when they think about their workforce. So, yes, you've got your role descriptions and you've got your org structures, but actually keeping the skills front and center, which when you focus around the skills that we need currently, the skills that we don't yet have, it kind of makes it a bit easier to see, okay, so where are the priority needs then for equipping our existing team, but also for adding new staff. Yeah, a lot of leaders were saying that's a helpful framework they use for them to make those kind of hiring decisions, and allows you to be more flexible, because then if you focus on kind of the traditional approach was maybe quite hierarchical, thinking about org structure, and it's a lot harder to make changes then and to adapt. But if you're focused more around the skills that we need and the skills we have, yeah, like role descriptions might change, job titles might change, like those things can flex and change as needed, but keeping the skills front and center was a key theme that came through from the people we surveyed.
Yeah, and I think it's relevant for all generations in terms of upskilling and retraining. But I remember one of our studies in the last couple of years, our Generations Defined one, and it's a slide that I always use in every presentation I talk about with regards to work or attracting and retaining, which is this question we asked about what is most important to you when looking for a new job. And it was really interesting because every generation had a different kind of top answer. And I know for younger generations, it was about learning and development and training and career progression. Whereas for the older generations, it was a bit more around flexibility, especially for the Gen Ys who were in those family forming years. For Gen X, it was remuneration. And for baby boomers, it was convenient location. So it was really interesting to see the differences, but younger people saying, oh, as we start out, we really need to be learning and developing. And I know for us, the generational perspective is really key to any topic that we explore, but especially in this one where we're talking about human resources and how people might differ, and not to say that everyone always fits into those generational insights, but it's a really fascinating area to be thinking about. What kind of generational perspectives or nuances or differences did this study kind of reveal or explore?
Well, that was one of the fun things about getting to do this large-scale research across the different countries, because that represents different cultures. So there was some interesting cultural differences that emerged between countries. But then you add in the age/generational lens too. And, I mean, that's the reason we talk about it so much at McCrindle, is because we know that as people are living longer, working longer, there's actually just by demographic change alone, there's more generations at work in the workforce than before, because people are living and working longer into their lives. And yeah, so we kind of asked some questions to understand what were leaders doing in relation to their thinking about, like, the generations at work, and was that a factor in their thinking? And it definitely came through really strongly. We had actually 72% of leaders said their organization is putting significant effort into attracting and retaining the next generation of workers, Gen Z. So I mean, naturally, everyone's always going to be thinking about the future generation to an extent for business continuity. But to have 3/4 of leaders saying we're putting significant effort into attracting and retaining Gen Z, like, I thought, yeah, that was probably higher than I expected, but in a positive way. Mm. So we had, you know, there's a challenge at the younger end where they're really trying to engage, to attract and retain Gen Z, this kind of new generation of graduates and workers. But then there's a challenge at the other end of the age spectrum. The aging workforce is also a challenge. And and actually 2/3 of leaders said the aging workforce is a key challenge for their organization too. So trying to grapple with why you're attracting and retaining the younger workers. Actually, you've got significant experience and skills and organizational knowledge and history, often kind of wrapped up in people who might be getting towards the twilight of their working lives. The challenge of getting those generations, you know, working together, getting that knowledge shared. Leaders definitely felt like that's a challenge that they're very conscious of at the moment.
Mm. And it's, like you said, I think a lot of the focus can be, especially when we talk about attracting, I think maybe that word naturally leads us to think young people, graduates, what's coming next, that's the future, and that is true. But there's so much, there's a wealth of information and knowledge, and sometimes we talk about the wealth transfer, but also almost like the knowledge transfer from older generations who we don't want to leave the workforce without imparting their wisdom down through to the younger or emerging generations of leaders or employees. So it's definitely, like you said, happening at both ends, which is great to see that organizations are aware of the different generations, how they're mixing, how we can kind of get the best out of everyone to create better workplaces, better products, better services, whatever that industry or sector they work in. So there's some generational insights. Were there any differences across the countries or nuances that the research showed as well?
Yeah, this was one area of the study where there was a distinct kind of difference between some of the different countries we surveyed the leaders in. And I think it just reflects how, yeah, some of these things they can be or not be kind of culturally embedded. And so that kind of cultural attitude, those cultural attitudes, they take time to change. And so, for example, leaders in Australia and New Zealand and ASEAN, so that's a group of countries, but Singapore being kind of a key one there. So Australia, New Zealand, Singapore, leaders there were actually more likely to feel that intergenerational knowledge transfer is happening effectively in their companies, compared to leaders in Japan, South Korea, Hong Kong and Taiwan, for example, with Japan being a particular kind of outlier where on a number of metrics, though, they felt those challenges, particularly around the younger generation. So I think it just highlights that, yeah, for leaders working in kind of cross-cultural context or kind of in multinational companies, that there will be cultural factors at play in your kind of people leadership and staff development and team dynamics. And it's going to be important to be aware of that. And probably countries like Australia and New Zealand, it seems, are maybe a bit more forward thinking when it comes to thinking about, yeah, the younger generations at work and engaging them and providing that kind of multi-generational knowledge transfer. The research kind of suggested that might be the case. So there's definitely things there that leaders can do if they are operating in some of those more kind of Asian cultures that I've mentioned.
Mm. Yeah, for sure. And I love, that this was such a big study and really great to always look at the nuances across generations, across location, and to be able to do that on a more global scale is always really fascinating. So thanks for sharing that. I think we've talked a little bit about flexibility, and I know that has been a real characteristic of the world of work over the last 5 years since the pandemic, and has gotten a lot of attention around hybrid work and what humans are going to do for work in the future, how we're going to work, a mix of sort of technology and social change around, you know, how work's done, where it's done, the role of HR in that as well, in a kind of more decentralized maybe world of work, it's an interesting kind of area to be thinking about, and then to weave HR into it and the connection between these two kind of areas is really interesting. I know you mentioned the future of work is going to be more human, not less, which I'm sure many of us will be delighted to hear about, and that we're not all going to be working in super futuristic AI-driven worlds, although I'm sure AI will be a big part of our future. But what did the research reveal? What can you share about what it revealed in terms of flexibility and the future of work?
Yeah, well, I think it was, again, just confirming other tides, to use that language again, mm-hmm. of, you know, things that we've been observing. But in so many organizational contexts at the moment, it's just highlighting how the social dimension to work and the human dimension is just more mm-hmm. important than ever. And companies that invest in those social connections and in those kind of social skills and in the human interactions are the ones that are doing well and actually set up to do well into the future. And I think, for example, like leaders said, the top well-being challenge is mental health. And I think it's easy. I think we have all these discussions about technology and there's so many benefits to technology, but in terms of the future of work and the future of HR and people leadership, if you're looking after your people well and they're feeling like they're thriving at work, then that's going to set you up to succeed, because for so many businesses, they say that actually people's mental state, their well-being is kind of the biggest organizational or like leadership HR challenge at the moment. So I think we can appreciate how people's mental state and their that really does impact the energy, the passion and the productivity they bring to their work. Stress due to overwork was a close second when we asked people what are the top kind of well-being challenges that they see in their team. So again, having an approach that a structure that supports people to manage that, to manage workloads is going to be important. But also that, people will say this is just accelerated in the last few years. So we ask people about their investment in employee well-being programs, for example, and 2 in 3 leaders said that they're developing employee well-being programs more than they were since the global pandemic. So the investment in that is increasing. There was definitely recognition there that fostering good mental health and good work well-being are important to set up teams to succeed. So those were some, this kind of the mental health aspect, which is, you know, is a big challenge at the moment. And so hence why, again, future of work, when you think about the human aspect, not just the machine aspect. But I think some of the other hints were in the ways that people say that they're responding and trying to address those challenges. So key themes were investing in training and development, which we've mentioned before, has many benefits. But also leaders saying that they're dialing up the communication and the regular feedback. And that's something that I know that you've talked about on this podcast before, about particularly the younger generations who seem to be wired to be wanting and needing that more regular ongoing feedback, even if it's more informal, as a way to be really engaged and at work. And I saw there was some articles kind of doing the rounds on LinkedIn on their kind of curated news around Gen Z at work. And there was some, it wasn't our research that was featured, but it really aligned in many ways. Some of the other studies that were being mentioned about the younger generations kind of really seeking out, being more engaged at work actually was what they were showing. And the ways that that's manifesting is, wanting that more regular communication and feedback. So I think that, you know, the ways that leaders are doing that, it's, things like an annual staff culture survey can be helpful. But, you know, even beyond that, not only collecting the data, but the companies that are collecting it, but then also sharing that feedback and sharing those learnings with the team of like, well, actually, here's what you've shared, here's what we're doing about it. that just creates a really positive feedback loop for people to then actually be more engaged to then give that feedback in the first place, so that and I think that's going to help engage the individuals, for them to know that their feedback that they do their feedback is valued, and their ideas and input is appreciated. But also it helps employers, because they're getting the benefits of hearing from people on the front lines about what's, you know, what are the friction points and what things can be tweaked or overhauled to kind of set up the business to succeed. So it just seems like a virtuous cycle, really, when that employee-employer feedback kind of loop is working well. So that was a key, one of the key takeaways as well that I noted.
Yeah, absolutely. And I guess a big part of that as well is, well, it's almost based on the premise that an organization values HR and is listening to them, and they have a really important function. Because I guess, I mean, I've seen it through, you know, memes online or even on LinkedIn where, you know, something's like, just go to HR. Like, I think, not that they've gotten a bad rap, but it's not an easy job. And I remember even when I was in high school and some people were like, oh, I'm good with people, so just, I'm going to go work in HR. And I'm like, HR professionals need to be respected, because they, like we've talked about, have such an important role in an organization and are dealing with a lot of people's challenges, and humans are complex, and we can't always separate work and everything else that's going on in our lives. And so they are tasked with a big role, not just in terms of helping and leading their people, but also looking to the future and looking to some of these trends. They play a really strategic role, I would say, in organizations. Did the research kind of, I mean, I'm sure it naturally spoke about this, but do you have any reflections on, I guess, that real strategy piece that HR plays in an organization?
Yeah, well, you're spot on, Ash. And that was actually one of the things that, one of the reasons to undertake this study, it started with Workday saying, well, actually, in speaking to leaders, this is what we're hearing. We're hearing that a lot more of them say that they're now part of board meetings regularly, and they're being involved in these kind of business-wide conversations, whereas they said in the past that wasn't necessarily the case for people in like the chief HR officer or chief people and culture officer kind of role. I think historically, like board meetings, you'd typically have like the CEO and maybe the chief operating officer if you have that role, maybe the chief marketing officer or something like that. But it seems that, yeah, and the research showed that actually kind of the top people leaders are saying that they're being involved in board meetings and board discussions more. So kind of providing that voice of the people, if you like, or the perspective of the people into those business decisions. So it's not just a decision being made on just the financials or just the marketing tactics or whatever it might be. So yeah, that kind of is one indicator to show how the people leader and the HR role is actually seemingly has evolved to become more strategic. Then yeah, I think definitely the cliche that I have in mind is, you know, take it to HR. Like, kind of HR is this very reactive, administrative, like they're only there to put out spot fires kind of role. Whereas that is not the HR leader of today, and that's not going to be the HR leader of the future. It's definitely more strategic, being part of more business-wide conversations, strategic conversations. 7 in 10 business leaders said that they believe their HR leaders are adding strategic value, and a similar proportion felt that actually they're the ones driving change. So that's also a bit of a shift, that again, the evolution of HR from more administrative and reactive to actually more strategic, more proactive. So I think that's probably a good takeaway for business leaders who may not be people leaders themselves, but if you're in a leadership role in a business, thinking about, well, how are our strategic decisions being made with an understanding or with data, with an appreciation of the impact on people, and not just in the negative, like avoiding the negative impacts, but actually like framing it in the positive of, well, from what we know about our team and our people, like what are some opportunities that presents for our business? So it doesn't just have to be a negative framing of just trying to avoid, you know, fallout from decisions, but actually framing that in the positive to bring, I mean, and that relies on having good data and insights from your team and people to share. So that's why companies invest in things like employee culture surveys, staff surveys, and of course we help many companies with those kind of surveys too.
Absolutely. Yeah, it's, I think those data sets that we can gather to help people bring insights that are concise, that are robust, is great, but also this kind of more broader public research that is about the profession, about this particular, like you said, very strategic role that a HR leader plays in an organization, and yeah, helping to bolster them and encourage them and show their value and some of the challenges that they might be facing, but also opportunities and how they can shape those into the future, is something we love to do and has been a great opportunity with Workday, like you said, Grant, to put this out, and a big shout out to any of our listeners who work in HR. Hopefully this research is encouraging and aligns with their experience as well.
Yeah, and listeners can just Google kind of McCrindle, Workday, this research, and you know they'll find it online. It's publicly available.
Yeah, we hope anyone who accesses that enjoys that read and those research insights, as I have enjoyed having you on the podcast today, Grant. So thanks so much for coming on and for sharing these great insights and the encouragement, hopefully all this is to HR leaders.
Yeah, shout out to the HR leaders. You're the real MVPs. Hope these insights have been helpful.
Absolutely. And if you would like to stay up to date with McCrindle's latest insights, we would recommend subscribing to McCrindle Plus for exclusive access to our latest reports, infographics, and masterclasses. And of course, you can also hit follow on this podcast or catch us on social media. So as always, thank you for listening and bye for now.